And now a reading from the Gospel according to John, chapter 12, verses 27 through 36. Jesus said, "Now my soul is troubled. And what should I say? Father, save me from this hour? No, it is for this reason that I have come to this hour. Father, glorify your name." Then a voice came from heaven, "I have glorified it, and I will glorify it again." The crowds standing there heard it, and some said that it was thunder. Others said, "An angel has spoken to him." Jesus answered, "This voice has come for your sake, not for mine. Now is the judgment of this world. Now the ruler of this world will be driven out. And I, when I am lifted up from the earth, will draw all people to myself." He said this to indicate the kind of death he was going to die. The crowd answered him, "We have heard from the law that the Messiah remains forever. How can you say the Son of Man must be lifted up? Who is this Son of Man?" Jesus said to them, "The light is with you for a little longer. Walk while you have the light, so that the darkness may not overtake you. If you walk in the darkness, you do not know where you are going. While you have the light, believe in the light, so that you may become children of light." The word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. I want to tell you each how grateful I am for the opportunity to serve this congregation and also to travel a few times each year to take others to the Holy Land. I think we're building something really special, and I don't take that for granted. So it's good to be back with you, and I'm grateful for those opportunities to travel. I wrote this sermon on the airplane from Israel back to Boston. I knew I would want to share some reflections from my travels with you. I also decided well before I left that I wanted to stick with the theme of these past 5 weeks when we have been thinking together about the purpose of the church, why it is the church exists. Throughout Lent, we have been reflecting on the purpose of the church. We've talked about the purpose of the church as the end of proclaiming the gospel. The church as a place for the shelter, the nurture, and the fellowship of the children of God. The church exists so that we can worship that God. The church exists to tell the truth. And last week, Cindy Coleman talked with you about the church, the church's role to proclaim social righteousness. Today we come to the last of those six great ends of the church, to exhibit the kingdom of heaven to the world. Jesus told countless stories about what the kingdom of heaven is like. It is like a king who threw a great feast and invited the poor and the lame to come and eat. The kingdom of heaven is like a sower who scattered seed extravagantly on every kind of ground. The kingdom of heaven is like a large tree with room in its branches for every kind of bird to come and build a nest. The kingdom of heaven is like a woman who rejoices when she finds her precious lost coin. Jesus didn't have just one story to tell what the kingdom of heaven is like. He used lots and lots and lots of stories. But he did make it clear that he expected his disciples to live as citizens of his kingdom, not the kingdoms of the earth. applies to his disciples back then and right now. In bringing my travels together with this call to exhibit the kingdom of heaven to the world, I began to think about the meaning of citizenship. Citizenship is a tricky thing in the Holy Land today. Before 1948, Israel did not exist as a state. So the people who lived there were technically subjects of the British Empire, and before that, the Ottoman Empire. They identified, though, mostly not as British or Ottoman, but as members of their family or clan or tribe. Today, any Jewish person in the world can immigrate to Israel and be granted citizenship in that country. The Arabs in Israel and the West Bank, however, live in a different reality. Some of them do have Israeli citizenship, but they don't have the same rights as their Jewish neighbors. Other Arabs in the Holy Land were granted Jordanian citizenship after the 1948 War of Independence. But since 1967, the West Bank hasn't been governed by Jordan. They may still, though, carry a Jordanian passport, even though they've never thought of themselves as Jordanians. To date, Palestine is not recognized as a state, and its government, the Palestinian Authority, has no ability to issue passports or grant citizenship. You can't be a citizen of Palestine. And what makes it even more confusing is that some Arabs would prefer Israeli citizenship, while others are avowedly Palestinian and committed to the creation of a Palestinian state. Somewhere over the Atlantic Ocean, I reflected on what a privilege it is for me to be a citizen of the United States, carrying one of those blue passports that allows me to travel with relative ease to almost any country in the world. I also thought about you all and the multiple citizenships and identities that you carry, regardless of the color of your passport. Some of you have endured great hardship to even get to the United States. And you have dotted every I and crossed every T and jumped through every kind of hoop to become citizens of this country. Even so, you still carry with you a deep love for the country that you left behind. Some of you, I suspect, are like a British friend of mine who married an American woman. He has a green card. He can live and work here indefinitely. But he thinks of himself as British. He does not, in fact, even want to become a citizen of the United States. Maybe that is some of you. Others of you here are still working to become citizens, and you're aware of how often those immigration laws shift and change and how difficult they can be to understand. Some of you, particularly some of the younger people among, you know, under 75, some of you were born here. You have been citizens of the United States since your birth. But your parents speak another language. And they remind you that you also have another identity, one that goes deeper than the country on your birth certificate.
citizens of the kingdom of heaven.
Just last Friday, like 4 days or 3 days ago, I was standing with our group on the top of the Mount of Beatitudes. We witnessed the morning sunlight glistening off the Sea of Galilee below as we heard Jesus tell the crowds that they were the light of the world and that they should let their light shine. We listened to the birds singing and inhaled the sweet scent of jasmine as we heard Jesus remind his followers not to worry about what they could eat or drink or wear, saying instead, seek first the kingdom of God. Most of the crowds who gathered around Jesus when he first told these stories were not the shining stars of their day. They were ordinary men and women, mostly peasants, who felt powerless in the face of the great Roman Empire that governed their lives. Most of them were not Roman citizens. They knew something about worry, about worrying that you have enough food to eat or enough money to pay your taxes. We're sometimes surprised to think that these are the ones who Jesus called blessed, that they are the ones whom Jesus urges to shine their light, however small it may seem. These are the ones whom he challenges to seek the kingdom of God above everything else. Living as citizens of the kingdom of heaven means that we are loyal first and foremost to God, as God has revealed himself in Jesus Christ. Every other aspect of our identity, the country that we belong to, the language that we speak, our culture, our ethnicity, all of that is subsumed under our primary identity as members of God's household. Living as citizens of the kingdom of heaven means that we also shine our light into the dark places in our world. When the darkness of our world presses in upon us, it can be tempting to feel like we have little light to shine. Sometimes we even have to face the reality that shining our light in the darkness is a danger to our health, our safety, as it was for Jesus. In today's reading from John, we see a Jesus who is troubled by the knowledge that his very life is at risk. Yet he still urges his followers to walk in the light. There's a lot of darkness still that haunts the Holy Land today. The land, unfortunately, has a history of oppression, where one group of people and then another and then another and then another has for centuries, even before the birth of Jesus, has claimed the land as their own, expelled or oppressed their enemies, and desecrated or destroyed the holy places. Our guide in the Galilee said that the people of the Holy Land aren't doing a very good job of living up to that name, holy. The Jews in Israel remember the darkness of the Holocaust some 80 years ago. They also still live in fear of violence today. There were 3 or 4 relatively minor violent incidents just in the time that Eric and I were there. And I say minor not because I think that life is cheap or that any act of terror is acceptable, but because I also remember that there were 10 shootings in the United States that claimed 14 lives in the 12 days that I was gone. Violence is part of our reality here, too. Arabs in the Holy Land also lived with darkness pressing upon them. The men and women who have called that land home since before the state of Israel existed are not free. They cannot travel freely from one city to another. They cannot obtain permits to build on land that has been in their family for generations. They have no due process in the courts of law. That pastoral beauty that my group experienced atop the Mount of Beatitudes is a sharp contrast to the insecurity and sometimes even brutality of life on the city streets below. So what does it mean to exhibit the kingdom of heaven in a place where the kingdoms of the world are still at war? How does a person find light to shine and have the courage to shine it? The kingdom of heaven is like a woman named Islam and her husband Ahmad. They have 6 children, including a son with a disability who requires full-time care. Before Islam was born, her family lived in a village west of Jerusalem. Their village was seized by Israel in the 1948 war, and the family has lived as refugees in a camp near Bethlehem ever since. In the camp, as in the surrounding city, there are very few services for disabled children and their families. Seeing other women in a similar plight, Islam was determined to light a candle of hope. 5 years ago, she founded a women's empowerment group with other mothers of disabled children. They worked together to care for each other's children, to create educational opportunities for those children, and to build bridges between the able and the disabled in their community. They still hope and to lobby for more services and resources for their families and for others. Our group spent just 4 hours with Islam and her family for a tour and a cooking class and sharing lunch together as a way to witness this small light that one family is lighting in a dark corner of the world. The kingdom of heaven is also like Rabbi Arik Asherman, a Jew who wants to create Israel as a safe, just, and free home for all of the people that live within her borders. Arik once rushed to a checkpoint to aid a 13-year-old Palestinian boy who was in trouble for throwing stones at the police. The boy was apparently getting roughed up pretty badly, and as Arik and 2 others approached, the police fired tear gas in their direction. Arik was undeterred and reached the boy, who is now being beaten. Both Arik and the boy were arrested. Later, though, when the young Muslim boy recounted his tale, he talked about the tall Jewish man in a kippah who stayed with him and told him not to be afraid. This, Arik hopes, might be a small light that endures in this young man's life. Islam and Arik, neither of whom are Christians, are already at work shining their light and exhibiting the kingdom of heaven to the world. Their stories remind me of another story that Jesus told about what the kingdom of heaven is like. The parable of the Good Samaritan. A religious outsider who exhibited the kingdom of heaven to the world when he cared for an injured man along his path. To live as citizens of the kingdom of heaven means that we will grant our loyalty first of all to Jesus Christ and his ministry on earth. all of our other citizenships and loyalties to our nation, to our culture, to our ethnic group. They are a distant second to our commitment to the creation of a heavenly state on earth. The Jewish faithful celebrate Hanukkah each winter as a reminder of the restoration of their temple some 160 years before Jesus was born. The holiday commemorates the end of a dark time in Israel's history and is celebrated by lighting candles on a menorah, adding one candle each night until all 8 candles are lit. It is a fitting celebration for the long, dark nights of winter. When we live as citizens of the kingdom of heaven on earth, we will be that light shining in the darkness. Our light does not need to be any brighter than that of a tiny first century Palestinian oil lamp. We do not have to, in one night, light all the candles on the menorah. But as Rabbi Arik reminded us, at some point, we have to light the first one. May it be so. Amen.